you shut off an engine, it actually gets hotter for a few minutes before it starts cooling down. This is because the coolant is no longer being circulated by the water pump, so by the law of equilibrium, it continues soaking up heat until it's the same temperature as the block, and then it'll cool down. Some really fancy high-end cars have electric water pumps that continue running after shutdown to help alleviate this issue, but the XJ is not one of them. We know engines need air to run. They have an intake system to get cold air and an exhaust system to get rid of hot air. On most engines, cold air enters from one side and exits the other in a cross-flow design. The 4-liter doesn't do this. Instead, it has both the intake and exhaust mounted on the same side, in what's called a reverse flow. Putting your exhaust on the same side as the intake isn't very thermodynamically efficient because the exhaust manifold ambiently heats up the intake air, which ideally needs to be as cold as possible for the maximum output from an engine. It also introduces vapor lock. Because the fuel rail is right on top of the manifolds, it also gets really hot. Now, gasoline, like any liquid, has a boiling point. If it gets too hot, it turns into a vapor. I know gas as a gas. Now, that boiling point can vary wildly depending on what additives are in it, which varies between every gas station. So, let's just say, for simplicity, about 250 degrees. The exhaust manifold can reach 5 times that temperature, but with air flowing through the engine bay as you drive, it isn't any sort of issue. When you stop and shut the engine off, the fans and the water pump stop spinning, and suddenly there's completely stagnant hot air in this enclosed space. Hot air rises off the exhaust and is trapped by the hood, so the fuel rail's temperature rises over gasoline's boiling point, and inside the rail, fuel evaporates. The injectors are not designed to inject fuel vapor, so they fail to deliver the fuel to the engine, which causes it to misfire. If you've ever warm started your engine before, it might stumble and misfire, in bad cases, barely stay running. But after a minute or so, it levels out, it calms down, and runs fine. This is heat soak on the Cherokee XJ, and in this video, I'm going to cover it in full detail to the best of my ability. Firstly, it only drastically affects 2000 and 01 models. We'll get into why those specific years later, but it can happen on the older ones too, only ever with the 4-liter. The other engines offered in the Cherokee are small enough and don't put out enough heat to cause vapor lock, and the 4-liter in other Jeeps has a much larger engine bay where hot air can escape it much better. So if you have any other Jeep than a 2000 or 01 Cherokee, this probably isn't relevant. We need to remember that the Cherokee was not originally designed to fit the 4-liter in it. At the start of its production run, the largest available engine was a tiny 2.8-liter V6 from GM, so the size and shape of the engine bay was designed around that V6. When the 4-liter was introduced, they really had to squeeze it in there and change some parts of the body to make it fit. It's so tightly packed in here that there isn't enough space for it to breathe. AMC knew this on day one. It's why they first used that weird pressure bottle for the cooling system, but that's a topic for another time. The cooling system is just enough to get by. Add any more heat, and we'll start to have problems. So what'd Chrysler do in 2000? Well, I'm glad you asked. The 50-state emission system found on some 2000s and all 2001s introduced a new exhaust manifold that features 2 catalytic converters in the engine bay. These suckers get hot. Usually in the range of 1,000 degrees, and they pack in all this extra heat right under our fuel rail, which causes vapor lock. The older Jeeps and Federal Emissions 2000 models don't have these catalysts on the manifold, so they don't usually ever get hot enough to cause any problems. Let's say you are having heat soak issues though, what can we do about it? First, there is a factory recall for this, if a dealership would still honor that. They install a heat shield right below the fuel rail. If yours is torn up, damaged, falling apart, they do sell these online. This kit includes wraps for all the fuel injectors too, which also helps. A band-aid fix is to just pop the hood open every time you briefly stop somewhere. This lets some hot air out as the engine sits, just remember to close it again before you leave. Otherwise, less enticing options include adding spacers to the hinges on the hood to raise it up enough to always let air out, I think this looks stupid, though, and of course it lets water in. A cleaner way to accomplish a similar thing is to add hood vents. Again, though, these do allow water in and are a pretty permanent modification, but they are very effective at not only eliminating heat soak, but keeping your engine cooler all around. I guess you could just take the hood off. I mean, there's no way you could get vapor lock without it.
I think you're missing something.
Yeah?
No, you're not missing a hood. You're missing a hood prop.
Oh, that's what it is.
Yeah, everything else looks fine.
And another thing I found was get rid of the automatic transmission. I know that's not really a feasible thing, but I used to have an automatic, and after I swapped in a manual transmission, heat soak was suddenly completely gone. The AW4 gets really hot and contributes a lot of that heat to the engine bay, where the manuals don't get half as hot, so that's technically another option. But otherwise, try changing the type of gas you put in it. Some stations have their fuel laced with a lot more ethanol than others, where gasoline boils at around 250 degrees, ethanol boils at around 180. So the more ethanol the fuel has, the lower its boiling point will be, and it'll be more prone to worse vapor lock. I have tested this with E15 gas. Sometimes you might find fuel with an octane rating of 88. This stuff is cheaper, but it makes less power and is a bit less efficient. It's also horrible when it comes to vapor lock. I have gotten myself stranded at McDonald's before because the engine could not run with how badly the gas evaporated. It literally wouldn't start, so I just had to sit there and wait for like 10 minutes for it to cool down, and then it was fine. Regular 87 octane gas has never done that, though. It'll just misfire at worse. In that regard, 87 octane itself varies by gas station. In the Midwest, there's this place called Quick Trip, which is actually a really good convenience store, but their fuel has noticeably worse vapor lock issues than a place like BP or Shell. Now, I haven't tested every single gas station, nor are any of my tests really scientific. Just, in my personal experience, these are the stations the 4-liter likes, and these are the ones it doesn't. I'm not saying don't buy gas from these places, I just tend to have consistently worse vapor lock issues with their gas. So try it yourself, you know, see what you think. If you always get gas from the same place, try switching it up and see if it runs any better or worse. So let's say you put in the best possible gas, have the manifold and injector heat shields, you pop the hood open at every stop, and you're still getting heat soak. The one final boss heat soak has been unable to defeat is the electric radiator fan. D&E in the garage had this excellent idea. You can run a switch to a time delay relay to override the radiator fan and let it run for a few minutes after engine shutdown. The electric fan is conveniently positioned to blow air right over the exhaust manifold and fuel rail on left-hand drive models. By simply running the fan, it evacuates the engine bay of all sorts of hot air, and the next time you start the engine, it runs good and smooth. This is what cured it for me. I never had heat soak again after wiring up this fan override. D&E simply jumped the time delay relay off the existing circuit. They work in tandem, so you retain the stock functionality and you can turn the fan on at any time. I decided to do the same thing, but slightly different. I ran a power wire straight to the time delay relay so I didn't have to stab wires into fuse box pins and cut holes in the cover, but it is much easier to do it that way if you don't care. Here's the wiring diagram for my setup, which again, I just copied D&E's homework and changed it up a little so I could take credit for it. Send power to pin 30, get power from pin 87. Pin 85 goes to the switch, which goes to battery power. Pin 86 goes to ground. The signal wire for your toggle switch should be fused with a 5 amp, and the power wire to the fan should be fused with a 40 amp. I just used a button on this delete panel for the export diesel models, so when I press that button, the fan comes on for about 2 minutes and then shuts off. If you have an automatic, I would set that delay to about 4 minutes.
Definitely check out the description on this one for a lot of links to all this stuff. This is the time delay relay. There's a little circle with an arrow in it in the middle down there. You stick a tiny screwdriver in there and you can spin that. That's how you adjust how long it stays on for. You can see the minimum is 2 seconds and the longest is 3 minutes. It actually goes up to almost 5 minutes, I've found. But yeah, I have mine set to like a minute 45 because that's all this Jeep needs. You can adjust it to your heat soak needs. When I had the automatic, I needed like 4 minutes out of this thing. When I manual swapped my original silver one, I didn't need this at all. Heat soak was just gone. This one though, that is also a manual, it does have a little bit of heat soak, just not as bad as the automatic did, even with all this stuff. As for why heat soak randomly starts happening and is worse on certain Jeeps and not as bad as an identical Jeep with all the same stuff, you know, I think it's because the heat shielding on the exhaust manifold itself, it rusts and decays over time, and it starts to let heat out of the catalytic converters. It doesn't trap it in as well, so more of the heat escapes and evaporates fuel in the rail. I think that's what's going on. I don't know for sure though. So I guess the technical way to properly cure heat soak would be to replace the dual catalyst exhaust manifold, which as you can imagine is probably in the range of like $1,000, and at that point I would rather just buy another Cherokee. Here's my whole wiring situation. This goes to the time delay relay. This one goes to the switch and the dash. I got them both fused right here. The dash wires I stuck through the rubber grommet under the master cylinder. And then here's the relay. And then from there, I just spliced it into the stock fan wire. You only need to do one splice, which is kind of nice. This, of course, retains all stock functionality. So when you turn on the AC or when the engine gets too hot, the fan will still automatically come on. Or at any point, either when there's no ignition power or you're running it and you're in some traffic or you're on some trails, you can manually toggle the override and it runs the fan for 2 minutes. I used to have it on this switch, but I find I just use the button more often. You know, I don't ever like need to leave the fan on, because I have a pretty well-maintained cooling system, which a lot of people don't really believe is possible, but it's all stock in here. And with that, thank you all for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.
He's not here.